is a discussion item, but a very important one, members, and I want to explain how this came about. We've been hearing a lot in the news about the molasses spill, and then we have the supposed sludge, which they want to call silt now, spill on the freeway that led to a lot of other questions about a particular marina possibly putting their silt into an area that they weren't supposed to, which it was my district. And originally we had started our discussions just with the city departments, and we realized that this really is an intergovernmental issue. And so we're going to be discussing basically for the audience that's watching and those that of your residents that have questions of how does government protect our constituents as well as our INA, and what are the different processes that people can take to either file complaints, as well as I hope to report back to our the committee chairs that these different items would relate to as possible legislation where we can improve our city services. And I look forward to reporting to state and federal agencies as well, and if your suggestions that come out of this discussion of certain laws that we should change or regulations that we can improve on. But before we begin, I just have to take a quick break real quick to ask a question. I see Representative Joe Jordan in the audience, and if you would like to, I'd love for you to come and join us and ask questions, because I know that you've been working really hard on this issue, if you'd like to. It's up to you. If members, you don't mind. Yeah. Thank you, Representative Jordan, for coming today. We have several panelists here today. My staff's so good, they gave you a little placard. Because you're very important to us. We have Jesse Pa'ahana, a biologist from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers Regulatory Division. From the state, Sam Lemel. Are you here, Sam? Oh, there you are, Sam. Planner for the Department of Land and Natural Resources. Of course, we have the director of the department, William Isla, who's here today. Thank you so much. We're so blessed to have you. We know that you were supposed to be somewhere else, and by chance, that meeting was canceled. So thank you so much. And of course, Alec Wong from a Chief Department of Health Clean Water Branch. And our very own Art Chalacombe from the Department of Planning and Permitting. And members, I hope you don't mind that we call our deputy director from DPP up first. And since this all kind of originated with the city, and we were referred to numerous departments for other issues. So deputy director, of course, for our office, this also started with the release of dredging material from the Hawaii Kai Marina that was released on Waianae private land. And for the committee members' information, I just want to give some information regarding this issue. On August 15th of 2013, this year, a constituent called our office, and as well as informed Representative Joe Jordan and other elected officials of the area, that a mysterious sludge-type material was being dumped on a private land next to certain Hawaiian homelands. We discussed this issue with other elected officials of the area, and we reported we believe that this was a city issue in this area. And so on August 19th, we sent a request for an investigation from the mayor's office, and Art's office responded the next day, having already sent an inspector there to the site, and they did give a notice of violation to the trucking company that was releasing the sludge-like material. And despite that, 11 days later, sludge was released on their freeway. And so it seems that a lot of work was done by our department, but the violations were ignored. And I'm going to let the deputy director kind of explain. We're just going to kind of use an example of once a report is sent to you, where does it go from there?
Okay. Thank you, Chair Pine. First of all, DPP got involved because there was a project, a dredging project that actually started several years ago with the permitting at the federal, state, and county level. And essentially, this was a project by the Hawaii Kai Marina Association. And they did receive all of the permits, the Army Corps permit for the dredging, the Conservation District use permit by DLNR, and a stockpiling permit that we issued at the location between Hawaii Kai Drive and Kalani Anioli Highway, a vacant site there, for essentially dewatering and testing. And essentially, that was the plan. And had the Marina Association stuck to the plan, we wouldn't be here today. Unfortunately, they did not stick to the plan. They had a trucking company take it to a off-site disposal area, agricultural land in the Waianae area, without receiving the proper grading permits from our department. And that's what essentially is the crux of the problem. Essentially, we did get, as you said, Chair, we did get that complaint. We are complaint driven, and as we get complaints, we send our inspectors to do investigations. And if the investigations show that a violation of city codes has been has occurred, then we do issue notices of violation. And we did, on September 6th, issue a notice of violation to Sandy Silva, owner of the property, that they were doing grading without a permit.
Now, did when you did respond the next day after we gave their complaint, didn't you give a notice to the Silva property owners or who was operating it at the time that they were in violation at that time?
I do believe our inspectors told them that. Again, they were to immediately remove the what we call spoil material. That's mm-hmm. the technical term that coastal engineers use for dredging projects and coastal projects. But they did not do that. Instead, they opted to submit an after-the-fact grading permit application, which I did review and have found, you know, it to be very lacking in its accuracy and information. So they're a long way from granting or from a DPP granting any grading permit from them. And in fact, you know, I've instructed staff that we will not issue a grading permit until the federal permits, the Army Corps permit, and the Conservation District use permits are either amended and the sites that were approved be amended to this particular site, which I doubt will occur. But that basically leaves the Silvas the option, if they can't get a grading permit, to bring the spoil material back to the stockpiling site. And that would correct the violation. If they do not do neither, that is, receive a grading permit or remove the spoil material and take it back to the stockpile site, then we will issue civil fines. If correction is still not occurring, then we will put a lien and and at the very end, foreclose on the property.
So when your inspectors went out right after we contacted you and gave the notice that they did not have the permit to release the material on the Waianae property, so they were supposed to stop those actions immediately.
That's part of the notice of violation, is that they were supposed to stop, and apparently they did not. And by the by November 6th, when we issued the permit, they had brought in 313 cubic yards.
Now we issued the violation, you mean, which, September?
Yes, yeah. By September 6th. Now, that might sound like a lot of truckloads, but the stockpiling permit actually contains 12,000 cubic yards, approximately 12,000 cubic yards. So you can imagine if we hadn't received a complaint at that time, and nobody would have said anything, the problem would have been, you know, far worse.
So based on the information, the application that you received from the Silva Trucking Company, you believed it to be deficient, therefore your department will be denying them a permit currently?
Yeah. Essentially, they have asked for an extension of time, which we normally grant any applicant and violator. So October 7th is the date that they were to comply, and they essentially have asked for a November 7th deadline, and that we will give one more 30-day extension. That's or one 30-day extension. After that, we will commence with our civil fines. I do not expect that they, given the deficiencies of their grading permit application, that they will be able to obtain a grading permit by that time. And like I said, we will work with our sister agencies cooperatively and to ensure that their permits and our permits coincide environmentally.
So to get out of their violations, they need to bring the material back to the Hawaii Kai locations where the Army Corps and the state designated as the disposal sites?
Unless the Army Corps and DLNR were to allow the Silva's property as an approved disposal site on the permits, and basically amend those permits, causing us to be able to proceed with the grading permit, we're not going to grant the grading permit.
Okay, so you're going to deny it for now then?
Yes.
Okay. And so they get these extensions, and so when do the fines start to begin?
Given that we're going to grant an extension November 7th, 2013, and there will be no further extensions after that date.
Now, is there anything in the city, state, or federal law that if a community deems that certain material released in their area or community to basically damage the things in their environment, is there any way that the community can demand that these type of items be removed immediately? Because what if there's a big rain and, for example, this silt that came from the marina was designated for to be disposed of in high areas with high salt water content, and instead it was dumped inland near a stream area that would not be able to survive a high salt water disposal into the stream, as well as any agriculture that cannot handle anything with a high salt water content. I think the frustration with the community is it seems like we'd have to wait 60 days. Is there another way to get these items removed?
Unless it can be determined that there is an immediate health and safety hazard this is our normal procedure, is to go through the NOV and notice of order process for civil fines. As of yet, we don't know if the soils are contaminated. That was part of our review and demand of the applicant to provide us that data. But right now we have no definitive information to that effect. The applicant, or applicant and violator, the Silvas, have installed a silt curtain as a best management practice around the spoil material to contain the material should there be any rainstorms that would potentially wash into the stream.
This was a recent addition after your department approached them. And
yes.
When was that done? Do you know?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
But it is has been first of all, for any grading permit issued, we require best management practices, and one of the foremost types of containments are use of silt curtains for soil material.
Okay.
And it has been installed.
Members, any questions?
Mm-hmm.
Councilmember Monahan?
I was just curious as to, you know, the relationship between the you know, where the materials were being dumped, the truckers, and then, you know, the people, I guess, dredging. I mean, how did that even happen, I guess? Maybe from the permitting standpoint, I don't know.
Council member, you would have to ask the Hawaii Kai Marina Association president, Mr. Clark. I think he has the answers to that. Again, as I pointed out, there's this project has a number of permits that are required, federal, state, and local. The coordinator, or the originator of all of these permits, was not necessarily the truckers. It was an SAR, I think it's SER is the trucking company that's involved, and I think that's the same as the Silva's property, the same company. By the way, we issued a second notice of violation to the Silvas for running a trucking operation and storage facility on agricultural land. So it's also a land use violation that we've issued. So we actually have two violations that have occurred. But again, I don't know how to answer that. Essentially, we came in relatively late in the process, you know, through this violation. Had, again, the Marina Association stuck to the plan, we would not be here today.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Let me just follow up real quick, and then we'll go to Councilmember before I forget again. So you had said that you would have to be given information that would show that any type of material that a community is concerned about would possibly damage the environment. Who do you consider as acceptable experts to give you that type of guidance?
Well, normally for grading permits, it would be our department because we would look for the type in any kind of grading. We would look to see that if the material had oil in it, concrete, organic material, things that our inspectors can see and feel. In this case, what we might be talking about, if we're talking salt on there and salt damaging freshwater streams, you can't see that. It's basically saturated in the soils. So I think it can be logically deduce that if spoil material is taken from a saltwater environment, that and even when it goes into the stockpile area for dewatering, the salt crystals would still remain into that soil. We don't have the lab facilities. We would ask the applicant to provide that information to us prior to issuance of the grading permit.
And then you talked about the land use violation. Was that just something recent of them using a operating a trucking company on ag land?
Actually, it's not that recent. They had been cited before and essentially corrected the violation for the same thing. This was a year or so ago. And then they corrected, so and removed the trucks and other vehicles off of the property, so we corrected the violation. Now it's back again, different trucks, different vehicles, but it's a recurring violation, so we're going with, because it's a recurring violation, we're going with civil fines on that land use violation.
Immediately?
Yes.
Not the extensions?
Okay. No extensions on a recurring violation.
Okay. Councilmember Harimoto.
Thank you. So, Mr. Deputy Director, you described the process of the issuing of the notice of violation and the almost automatic extensions as your normal process. But I guess what I'm wondering about is, but the issuing of the extension is discretionary. So in this case, I mean, I guess what I'm thinking is this seems to be willful and almost egregious kind of violations. So, I mean, don't you have discretion in that case to say, because this is such a severe violation, that civil fine should kick in earlier?
Okay. Well, it is discretionary. And if there is, again, life safety or health hazards that can be documented, we would not issue an extension. But we do normally issue an extension, and what I'm looking down the road, if we do not issue an extension, and in other words, we treat this applicant differently, because they do have a grading permit application. If we treat them differently, if we go to court, that may come up, is that we were prejudicial. Because right now, we don't have that evidence that the material is indeed hazardous. In fact, other than the salt content that may be there, some of the reports that I've reviewed so far seem to be that the soil is safe.
But I guess that's what I'm getting at. So what I'm hearing is only on the condition that something is health and safety related or urgent would you not issue the extension. But it seems to me that if there are severe violations, you should have the opportunity to perhaps not give the extension. So maybe your rules need to be revisited or... I understand what you're saying about, you know, treating this one differently, but I guess this to me seems to be so severe and so egregious that I have problems with saying, okay, we'll just give them an automatic extension. I don't even live out that way, but I'm pretty outraged by what's happened.
I understand your concern, council member. I wish I could say that this was a really egregious violation that I've never seen anything as bad, but unfortunately I see violations that are even worse than this.
Is that right?
Yes, in terms of quantity, in terms of life safety, and in a lot of times hazards. That's unfortunate that we have this, and it's not just this dumping in Waianae. It's throughout all of Oahu, especially in the rural areas.
So I'm surprised to hear that. I guess it's enlightening for me to hear that. But I think it even strengthens my point that perhaps we need to have new rules to allow us to kick in the fines, more severe fines, perhaps early on.
We would have to change our rules. The $150 a day fine is based on DPP rules, based on cubic yardage. Again, like I said, we're talking 313 cubic yards that were deposited on the Silva site, and that's relatively small compared to violations that that I've witnessed in the past.
Okay, well, I guess I don't want to prolong it, but perhaps I would ask if you can revisit those rules to discourage these kinds of things from happening. Thank you.
We will do so.
Representative Jordan, do you have any questions?
If you don't mind. Mm-hmm. Thank you for allowing me to join you. Thank you, council members. I appreciate it. When you're talking about the first violation, which was the actual staging of the material and no grading permit, so I understand that you're probably going to allow them the extra 30 days up till November 7th, correct?
That's correct.
More than likely, to do all your due diligence to see if they're truly in violation.
Although, they are in violation.
Well, yeah, I understand that, but as Councilmember Breen Harimoto has said, egregious. And I think they probably are very egregious in what they're doing, because I don't think it's going to change. So, say for instance, we move forward. They get the 30 days till November 7th. They don't move any action to remove the material. You don't offer them the new grading after the fact permit, because I'm not so sure that they're going to get the changes in those other two permits. And they just don't move anything. You move into your $150 a day. You know, in my opinion, rules might need to be altered in the future, because that's like $5,000 a month. At what point in time do you start leaning somebody's property and move forward on condemnation of the property due to fines being so excessive to the city? Because I do know of one piece of property that was located in Makaha where they had city fines to the tune of about $150,000, and you never move forward on seizing the property, and it had gone on for years. So I mean, not to say it's right of these companies to do these type of things, but I think they understand how to push these rules so far to just eventually walk away and say it's now the city or the government's problem to deal with it. You know, how do we look at, you know, going forward with this when we may assume that it might not be cleaned?
We will give the applicant, the violator, their due process. We have to do that if we're going to be successful ultimately in court. And believe me, if we lien the property, if we foreclose on the property, we will be in court. So we have to go through a process of a due process so that we can be successful.
And just a follow-up to that, however, going back to your original statement, if the community does get someone credible that can prove that any type of material with the highest salt water content is damaging to inland living organisms as well as to our stream beds, that would be something that you would take very seriously and take more immediate action on?
We will certainly consider that, yes.
Okay. Members, any other questions? Thank you so much for coming today. Definitely, we have a lot more questions in the future and look forward to working with your department to be more effective for the public in this area.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I wanted to call the Army Corps of Engineers forward. Jesse, your boss is here. Okay, do we have a plaque?
Good afternoon, council members. I'm George Young. I'm the chief of the Honolulu District's regulatory branch of the Army Corps of Engineers.
Thank you so much for coming. We're so excited that you're here today, and we know that you're very busy. Our whole purpose of this hearing today, of course, it started with our city department and a lot of questions relating to, of course, the molasses spill. Then, of course, you have the freeway incident and some dredging material from a marina being dumped on private land in the Waianae area. And we realize this is really more of an intergovernmental issue where we each have our different sections, and the public in some meetings that Representative Joe Jordan and I went to feels that government isn't doing anything on this issue. And so I really wanted to help educate the public as well as myself and the members to see how we can do a better job from the city level to coordinate with you. And so we really are just using, start off with using example of the Hawaii Kai Marina Association permit, which was a topic in the public, so everyone pretty much knows about that. event. And they applied for a permit with the, your department, with the Army Corps of Engineers, to dredge material. And I think what we need to understand is how your process works when there's some violations. And it was reported, according to your permit documents, that the Marine Association, for example, was only supposed to dispose of, according to your permit that we approved with them, of several areas, dispose of the dredging material in several areas in this Hawaii Kai surrounding a marina area, yet the dredged material was disposed of in a PVT landfill, which is in Nanakuli area, as well as private land owned by Silva's and SCR Trucking. And so I guess using this as an example, what happens at this point if someone that has a permit with your department doesn't follow the permit and violates the permit?
Well, let me step back by mentioning, with regard to discharges or placement of material in general, the Corps' authority under the Clean Water Act is limited to discharges of dredged material or discharges or placement of fill material into waters of the United States. Our regulations actually define a geographic boundary for our permitting authority as the ordinary high water mark of a waterway or the identified boundary of a wetland. In conjunction with any permits we issue for either work in navigable waters, such as a maintenance dredging, or work in discharges of fill into waters, for instance, grading projects, our span of control actually we exert over the permitted activity itself, and then depending on the actual permit evaluation itself, in the case of Waianae Marina, they were subject to an individual evaluation, which is across the full range of public interest factors in our regulations. In those cases, the activity we're issuing a permit for, we will assert jurisdiction control over the permittee's activities that result from our permit decision. So in the case of maintenance dredging for Waianae Marina, the Corps' span of control includes the disposal activities. For dumping in general, not associated with one of our permits, we would pursue that as an enforcement case if the material is within waters of the U.S. And I would add the alleged violator in that case under federal regulations is actually the property owner, not necessarily the company or entity disposing the material. So there's a fine point there.
When you say property owner, sorry to interrupt you, the property owner of the marina where the material was taken off of, out of the waters that you preside over, or where it was
the instance I just mentioned, to clarify, I was referring to an instance where there is dumping of material that's not in conjunction with a permit we issued. In that case, the Clean Water Act violation in the eyes of the federal regulations is actually the property owner. It may not necessarily be the construction company or the hauling company that disposed of the material. But in this case, Waianae Marina is our permittee. Mm-hmm. And in the eyes of the Corps, the permittee, their contractors, contractors, subcontractors are subject to the terms of our permit.
And so just to clarify for the members, according to the permit, with the Hawaii Kai Marina Association and the Army Corps of Engineers, the material that was dredged from the marina in multiple locations were supposed to, according to the permit, be disposed of in the following locations: Rim Island number 1 within the Hawaii Kai Marina, the Hawaii Kai Yacht Club property within the Hawaii Kai Marina, Port Lock Beach, fronting homes along Kalaniana Honolulu Highway and Manalua Bay, Manalua Bay Beach Park, South Oahu Ocean Dredging Material Disposal Site, approved by the, which is offshore. And so, George, so there are two locations that are not listed here. And so for the Hawaii Kai Marina Association to release this dredge material on the Waianae private property as well as at the PVT landfill, how would they be allowed to do that under this current permit?
Well, to do that validly, the as you can see from your copy of the permit, the material is obviously placed in a location, not in one of the five locations the Corps authorized. Aside from the issues of specific locations, for our permittee to use a disposal site other than any of the five in their permit, they would normally be required to submit a written request for modification of the permit for us to review through our normal process before we approved any disposal site other than the five in their permit.
Was this, did this occur?
It did not.
Okay. So then what happens after this? I understand that, then I apologize that because I'm working so closely with the city on this issue, I was given a copy of a letter that you did send to the marina, but it's up to you to if you want to release what was said. But basically, they're in violation of your permit.
That's correct.
Therefore, means they're in violation of federal law?
We have issued them a notice of noncompliance with their permit, indicating we have made an assessment they may be in violation of certain federal laws. Accordingly, we have an investigation underway to go through the available information and inform our own agency as to the status, understanding the relationship in their contract documents between their contract with American Marine, the material in Waianae. And that's part of a suite of information that we'll be using to inform our agency as we develop a resolution for this violation.
Is there anything that we can do in our processes in the city to improve our relationship with your department? Or do you feel that the certain processes are okay at this time?
Well, certainly from the standpoint of how we operate in our permitting process is a broad perspective. While we're evaluating permit applications, we recognize the fact that on occasion different levels of government have overlapping responsibilities. They really should be complementary. At the tail end of a permit decision, the enforcement of compliance with permits, our federal regulations actually recognize the opportunity for other agencies outside of the Corps of Engineers as well as the general public to assist the federal government in the enforcement of our permits. We actually encourage the permit decision maker, the district engineer, for the Corps to seek out information, observations, and similar input from other agencies as well as the community in helping us monitor our permittees. That's actually a part of federal regulation.
And so in this instance, you find that, for example, the Hawaii Kai Marina Association violated their permit. What are the penalties under federal law if you do find this to be so?
The noncompliance, it can be upwards of $10,000 a day per violation. One of the perspectives we take in looking at actions on the part of our agency to resolve both noncompliance with our permits as well as unpermitted activities is, as a matter of national policy, our focus is on the health and the protection of the aquatic environment. Procedurally, under federal regulations, penalties such as that, and typically those are often assessed as part of litigation as we wrap up the most egregious cases, fines coming out of our administrative penalties actually go into the U.S. Treasury, so they actually don't benefit the environmental resources that we're charged with protecting. Oftentimes, to resolve most enforcement cases, we are looking at having the violator restore the site, as well as providing mitigation to offset the environmental damage that occurred as part of their violation. Quite often, on a national scale, that we find that preferable to issuing fines.
Thank you. Questions, members? Yes. Councilmember Minahan?
I'm just curious. Okay, so the Army Corps of Engineers determined the five locations where the where this material could be placed after dredging. Is that correct?
Then we approved them as part of our permit. They were actually proposed by the applicant themselves. They're a combination of disposal sites they control, and also for recognizing some of the dredged material was expected to be clean beach sand suitable for nourishing beaches. I believe this was in conjunction with their conservation district use permit. A part of the core permit recognized the desire of the association to place clean beach sand back in Honolulu Beach Park, Bay Beach Park. Hence, the beach park locations as two of the authorized disposal sites. Those sites were specifically envisioned for the clean beach sand and not necessarily the more contaminated materials from the interior.
Okay. So I guess what I was particularly offensive, I guess, to the community of Representative Jordan and Councilmember Pine is the decision to place the materials in those five sites, but the decision to chuck it out and dump it somewhere else inland. I guess my question would be, and not to say, I mean, that's absolutely offensive, but if you were considering using it as sand replenishment or putting it in other areas, I mean, how, what in your determination of these sites, well, I mean, how hazardous was the materials, or what did you expect was to come out of this?
As part of the marina's original application to do the maintenance dredging, they had envisioned from a prior permit application, which did not achieve a permit from the Corps, approach of disposing of the material at the existing EPA South Oahu dredge material dump site. And so this concept on the part of the association was actually before the Corps in a prior permit application around eight or 10 years ago. It was conveyed to the Corps that the association was interested in that option for reasons, two reasons primarily. One, lack of available land within their control for the total quantity that they envisioned being dredged. And second, they had an authorized disposal site, Rim Island 2, that was created as a part of the original dredging of the Waianae Marina that had actually over the years become endangered waterbird habitat. And so there were going to be some associated environmental impact issues associated with using that site. So this is part of the longer history of the association working on options to dredge the marina and involving the Corps in some of the dialogue before they submitted an application the second time.
Yeah, but thank you. I appreciate the response. Mm-hmm. But just one question. Why were they doing the dredging in the first place?
There are portions of the marina. It was conveyed to the Corps that there were issues with groundings, folks dragging propellers under Cal Highway. Additionally, there were portions on the interior of the marina where it was conveyed to us that boaters simply weren't able to access the main waterways from where their vessels are tied up at their houses. It's been conveyed to us that it's been many years since the interior portions of the marina have been dredged, so that the association's individual homeowners were having problems accessing certain portions of the interior of the marina.
And the Marina is a private entity, or is it part of the...
It is a private entity.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Members, any other questions? Yes, Councilmember Kobayashi.
Could you clarify something? You said there were these five sites that where they were permitted to get rid of their stuff.
That's correct.
So two of them were the beaches, but you could only put sand there, is that right?
That's correct.
So, and then the other one was the rim...
There's a rim island one.
Mm-hmm. And you couldn't put anything there because... unless it was clean.
Those islands were, they were artificial islands created in the original dredging of the marina for the purpose of disposing
so
that waste
put
material.
Their material there.
Certainly.
Okay. I mean, it wasn't down to where those five sites were, did not work out. They could have... There were at least three sites where they could have...
There was certainly no information conveyed to the Corps that there were any challenges with using the sites they proposed.
But they somehow decided to truck it across the island.
That certainly appears to be the case, and this is...
They didn't communicate with you as to, the other sites were not... workable, so they had to truck it across the island. There was no communication.
That's correct. And that's one of the information pieces that we want some clarity on as we pursue our investigation. And we are planning to sit with them face to face to go through some of that information.
Sense. Yeah. Thank you.
Members, any other questions? Representative Jordan.
Yes, Chair. Do you currently know how much of this material may have been deposited in any of those other particular five sites?
I do not have that personally at hand, but we have required them to keep records of quantities. So we do have, as part of our permit with them, the requirement for them to provide us documentation on quantities at various locations.
Chair, may I?
Yes.
So I'm assuming, walk me through the process. So I'm going to get a permit. You guys estimate a guesstimate of how much material they're going to be pulling out of this particular area?
That's correct.
Right. So then they report to you at the end of the permitting process where everything was disposed of? I'm not quite clear
on
that.
Well, in this case, for various reasons, the Marina Association asked for a long-term permit. So they wouldn't have to reapply every time they did maintenance dredging. In this kind of instance, in order for us to monitor the progress of the permitted activity, we require a permittee like the association to provide us progress reports on increments of dredging. What quantities pulled out by their contractor, what dates, hauled to where, what location.
How often do they have to report those progress reports to you?
I don't recall that off the top of my head, but we do have that as part of our permit.
Okay, so when you say a long-term permit, is that 5 years, 10 years?
In this case, they were authorized for a five-year period, after which they would have to reapply for another permit.
In your estimate, how often would you have to dredge an area like that? Would it have to be once a year for 5 years or once every 5 years?
That might really vary with the location within the marina. Certainly the interior portions, the material being deposited in the marina is coming out of storm drains or washing over roads during the infrequent rainfall. The material that they would be dredging under Cal Highway is clearly washing in from the ocean, so that the frequency at different locations may vary depending on the source of the original material.
Chair, may I?
Yes.
So when it comes in near the bridge of the mouth where the ocean comes in, do they need a permit for that, or they can just do
under? No, ma'am. They need a permit for that as well.
So they wouldn't fall under like the city's permit that they have normally because they're a private entity?
There's a little overlap between our stream mouth clearing, maintenance stream out clearing general permit, and the Marina's desires. We would look at that more specifically from the standpoint of the intent of the dredging. In this case, the intent is to restore navigation capacity, whereas the city and county's permit, which actually can be used by private parties and state agencies, is more from the perspective of protecting public safety and property during rain season.
Do you know when the last time they received a permit to dredge their marina?
I do not recall that off the top of my head, but I believe that's more than 10 years ago.
Thank you, Chair.
Members, any other questions? Well, thank you so much, Mr. Young, for educating us on your process, and we look forward to working very closely with you from the city to make sure that we provide any assistance that we can to make you successful.
Well, thank you for the opportunity to be here.
Thank you. And the big guns came from the state. if maybe all three of you can come forward from the state, and there's three microphones for you, and this help us to understand how you folks fit in all this. And again, I do want to thank Director Isla, as well as Mr. Lemel and Mr. Wong for coming today. We are very blessed and honored that you're here to share your experience and as well as suggestions of how we can work better with you from this city. And so I don't know who to go to next. We were talking about water, so we're going to go straight to you, Mr. Wong, as chief of the water branch, the clean water branch. How do you fit into situations like this that we're discussing today?
Okay, the reasons we get involved is because, you know, the activity, they need a full permit from the Army Corps of Engineers. And before the Army can issue, you know, the federal permit, they need to get a Section 401 water quality certification from the state. Mm-hmm. And that's how we get involved.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and so I guess we were talking about the five sites, and I'll repeat them again for the members. So according to the permit with the Army Corps of Engineers, the Hawaii Kai Marina was allowed to dispose of the dredge material in five sites. Two of the sites were located within the Hawaii Kai Marina. One was at Port Lock Beach, one was at Mauna Lua Bay Beach Park, and the other one was the off-site disposal. So your department did not test to see if this material could be disposed of inland, for example, in the locations of the PVT landfill as well as the private land of the Silva property. Would that be something that you would have to approve?
If that is identified in the application under the Army Corps of Engineers, we will look at that. But in this case, I think that whatever happened right now is not on the disposal site, so we are not aware of that.
Okay. So your department then did not approve of the two disposal sites on the Waianae coast?
Not as I know. It's okay. Not in the application.
Okay. Members, any questions of Mr. Wong? Representative Jordan?
Mr. Wong, has there been a request for you to test what is currently at the Waianae site?
You mean tests of?
Tests of the silt that happens to be placed at a Waianae location that supposedly came from this Hawaii Kai Marina.
Normally, my program doesn't test, you know, those silt. You know, we just deal with anything discharged into any state water.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And so, you would not oversee inland water, like streams and things like that?
Inland water is part of my, under my program.
Oh, okay. And as part of your department's analysis of different material, do you take into consideration the fact that waters, of course, are different, as you and your expertise know, that saltwater fish cannot survive in freshwater areas, some of them, and that freshwater fish cannot survive in saltwater. Do you take into consideration in your analysis when material from salt-lying areas or that's a heavy salt content is dropped into perhaps a stream bed of freshwater, a freshwater stream bed?
I normally we don't. The reason is we deal with more is water quality.
Mm.
It's not like, you know, fresh water, salt water. I think that aquatic, you know, things probably may be Department of Land and Natural Resources, maybe.
Oh, okay.
I'm not too sure about that, but normally we don't deal with those.
Okay.
But we care about the discharge, you know, what they are discharged into the state water.
So would it be fair to say that state waters in the Hawaiʻikaʻi area could be very different in the content in the Waianae area? Or would you consider both sides of the island virtually the same in their water quality?
I think depending on the locations, you know, I don't think we can say that, you know, they're all the same depending on the locations.
So again, you would have to approve it, any type of discharge into state waters prior to it being done. And that was not done with your department.
No, we did, you know, review, you know, the Army Corps of Engineer, the applications, and then we certify if they follow the permit and follow whatever they propose. And in case they have a chance of discharge into the state water, they will comply with the state water quality standard. And that's all we certify. Because we don't issue a permit, you know, the permit is under the Army Corps of Engineer.
And so in this case, they didn't go through your department. And so does your department impose violations? Do you have that type of oversight when the proper investigation hasn't been made by your department?
So I believe you refer to the disposal site in Waianae, right? You talk about that. No, you're not talking about the permit itself, right?
No, no.
Right. That one is not under my program. That one may be under solid and hazardous waste program. And of course, whether they will need a permit from them, I'm not too sure about that.
Members, any other questions? Stay right there because we might be going back and forth for a little bit. We'll go to you, Director Isla, if you can help to explain how your department is involved in situations such as this.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today to participate in the discussion, Chair Pine, Council members. Basically, how the Department of Land and Natural Resources gets involved in this situation is the operation occurs on conservation lands, so land zone conservation. For work, maintenance, repair, construction on conservation lands, the requirement is that the department issue a conservation district use permit. Very similar to the Army Corps permit, the CDUP was approved basically with those five disposal sites being named in the permit. The fact that for the CDUP, a disposal site outside of the documentation associated with the application came to light to us is a possible violation. We have the Army Corps, we have our Attorney General's taking a look at that situation right now. I think the applicant has potentially opportunities to apply to the department, as they would have the ability to apply in the case of the Army Corps permit for a amended permit. We have not received any application as of today, so it's difficult to comment on what the outcome would be not having received an application. We're not sure if we have the ability to issue fines for a violation of a misrepresentation of information on the application. Again, our attorneys are taking a look at the situation right now. That's the extent of the department's jurisdiction in this case. We and Sam can follow up if I have left anything out, but we certainly it is a policy of the department that if there is good quality spoils in the form of sand, to put it back on the beach. That's certainly a department policy. So in the case of the clean spoils, the spoils that were basically sand that comes in from the ocean, the decision was made to put that back on the beach. Our understanding at the time of approving the application was any other spoils would be disposed of in the disposal sites named on the permit. And I think Alec might have misunderstood your question earlier. So, and I think you were proposing the question to Alec was the spoils that were deposited in Waianae or are adjacent to a stream.
Yes.
And if there was a discharge of that salt material into the Waianae stream, would that be a violation? And perhaps that's the question that I think they had posed to you, Alec. Would that be a violation? Because you have spoils that were placed near a stream, and if there was a breach in the containment of that material and it ended up in the stream, would the salt content be a violation of the Clean Water Act?
I think it's possible because the inland water, they have their own like salinity, and then the salt water, they have the different salinity. It's possible they may be a violation. But let's say, you know, it's very difficult to say, you know, what is the, until they have a discharge.
So currently there is no discharge, but if there is a heavy rainfall and the measures taken to prevent discharge does occur, that would be when your department would step in.
Maybe.
Okay. Members, any questions? Representative Jordan? So it appears that we do need to follow with the solid and hazardous waste department. Is that what you said?
If it trigger, they need a solid waste permit, and then they need maybe get to work with the our solid and hazardous waste department. I mean the program.
Okay. Yes,
Councilmember Banan.
I was with Joe Jordan here. I'm going back to our old days in the house.
Okay. I just was curious. Chairman, so who's in charge, I guess, of studying the spoiled material, I guess, now?
Terms of any potential pollutants?
Yeah, who's?
My understanding is the applicant should have provided at the beginning of the process an analysis of the spoils. And the spoils would have to be, when I say clean, I mean they could possess some pollutants to levels below acceptable levels. That's the only way that the permits could have been processed.
Okay. So, okay. But is there? I guess now that it's on the property on the land, is there? Would you have to study it again, or?
I suppose the Department of Health's solid waste branch. Now that it's no longer spoils, it's actually dried and it's in another form. Would be responsible for testing if someone requested them to test.
Thank you.
Okay, members, any other questions? What, in your opinion, can we do from the city level to work better with you to help you to succeed in your different departments?
You know, I think one of the lessons learned for us in the CDUP process is to build in a self-reporting system similar to the Army Corps, mm-hmm. where we get some confirmation that the disposal actually happened at the sites that are approved in the permit. So we will be taking a look at that and perhaps building in some clear violations should that not occur. We currently, I don't believe that it's very clear that we can do that, but that one of the lessons learned is that. And of course, continued communication with all of the entities involved.
Okay, great. Members, any other questions? Well, I want to thank all of you for coming today and helping us understand how we can do a better job working with the state and the federal government, as well as between elected officials, and because I think what the public wants is a clear plan of how they can be informed of the actions that they can take when they see violations in their communities, as well as an action plan from us of how we can do a better job of preventing these type of activities.
If I could add one thing, Councilmember Pine. Earlier, the representative from DPP testified that DPP would have the ability to approve the spoils remaining on site should one of the other two entities, i.e. the Department of Land and Natural Resources or the Army Corps, amend our permits to allow an additional disposal site. So they're waiting until, I think, November 11th is based upon, I think, actions that will or will not be taken by either the Army Corps or our department. Should we not amend our permits prior to the November 7th date, then the DPP would have to move forward on the violations.
Mm-hmm. And so just to recap, which would it be the solid, so the Department of Health Solid and Hazardous Waste Department would have the ability to test material to let the community know whether that material is compatible with the area that it was.
I believe because it's dried material now, that would be the appropriate division within the Department of Health to do the testing.
And is that something that, for example, Representative Jordan can make a request of the department, or does
yes.
it have to be, okay.
No, I think the council could, I think the representative could.
Okay. Yes, Mr. Wong.
But it's not official because I'm not running the program, but I doubt, you know, they will test the soil. You know, normally we don't do those testing, you know, but I'm not too sure, like I say, but I believe, you know, the applicants will be responsible to test the soil.
I think this is a situation where the community on the Waianae Coast would prefer an independent agent, not the applicant, to test the soil. So, Deputy Director?
As part of our review of the grading application at this point, one of our requirements is that the soils be tested.
Okay.
A grading permit will not be issued until we're satisfied that this material is suitable.
Okay. Thank you very much. That is important to the residents of the Waianae Coast, and I'm sure residents all over Honolulu that may have similar situations. So thank you. Well, thank you so much for taking your time to be here today. I please let us know how we can help you in the future to do a better job to work with you. Mahalo for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you, members, for... I'm sorry. I have to have anyone in the public wishing to testify on this item? We do not have any registered testifiers. I forgot to adjourn the meeting. I was so engaged with all of you. Seeing no further business or anyone wishing to testify, we hereby adjourn this meeting. Mahalo.